The pianist Glenn Gould is one of the most intelligent and articulate musicians on the scene today, and his comments about music are invariably as fascinating as his performances. His recorded repertoire for Columbia includes a disc with the three most familiar Beethoven piano sonatas, the Moonlight, Pathétique, and Appassionata, in brilliant performances. And Mr. Gould has also recorded incisive and illuminating commentary on these three works, which will be illustrated with excerpts from the actual recordings of the sonatas.
Among Beethoven's early piano works, the Sonata Pathétique is perhaps the most symphonically inclined. Its first movement is prefaced by an imposing grave statement, double-dotted and doom-foretelling, the sort which Beethoven employed as introduction to his first, second, fourth, and seventh symphonies, and although somewhat tangentially related to the main themes of the subsequent Allegro, it's firmly tied to it through its mood of grim determination and the opulent texture of its harmony. In the Allegro portion of the movement, Beethoven derives both dynamic and rhythmic propulsion from the persistent timpani-style tremolandos with which the left hand rigorously chaperones that ill-advised flirtation with rubato, which is the perpetual temptation of the right. This quasi-orchestral approach to the keyboard reappeared from time to time, especially in those rather blustery essays of his middle period, but most of Beethoven's subsequent sonatas explored more intimate and indigenously pianistic sonorities. Unlike the Pathétique sonata, in which the second and third movements scarcely live up to the symphonic pretensions of the first, the Moonlight sonata escalates from first note to last, beginning with what is unquestionably Beethoven's best-loved and most abused melody. The opening adagio resolves into the tantalizingly ambivalent whiff of D-flat major, which constitutes the second movement, and in turn this fragile and autumnal allegretto disappears within that flash flood of a concluding presto. This movement crystallizes the sentiments of the first two, confirming an emotional climate both flexible and assured. It's one of Beethoven's most imaginative finales and helps put the Moonlight Sonata deservedly high on the late 18th century hit parade. Like the Pathétique and Moonlight Sonatas, the so-called Appassionata Sonata, Opus 57, is usually ranked with the most popular of Beethoven's keyboard works. But I confess that the reasons for its popularity elude me. The Appassionata, in common with most of the works which Beethoven wrote in the first decade of the 19th century, is a study in thematic tenacity. The themes as such are usually of minimal interest, but often of such tenacity and primal urgency, one wonders why it took a Beethoven to think them up. No one had ever composed with so belligerent an attitude before. In some respects, no one has done since. And when it works, when Beethoven's furious onslaughts find their mark, one feels that music's rhetorical demands have been transcended by an affirmation at once personal and universal. But when they do not succeed, these works of his middle years are victimized by that same relentless motivic pursuit. And I think that in the Appassionata Sonata, his method does not work. In the first movement, the relation of first and second themes, both of them spawned by an arpeggiated triad figure, is to my ear out of focus, a subsidiary A-flat major motive following hard upon the opening F minor statement, and without benefit of that inexorable tonal strategy which guides Beethoven's more carefully considered expositions. The second movement is a set of four variations which derive from, but fail to expand, a somber confluence of primary chords in the key of D-flat major. The finale, like the last movement of the Moonlight Sonata, is essentially a sonata allegro, into which, prior to the coda, Beethoven interpolates a curious 18-bar gallop, which, with its souped-up tempo and simplistic rhythmic format, provides the compositional equivalent of those heroic gestures by which the experienced virtuoso gathers for the most ill-conceived interpretation frenzied approval from the balcony. For Beethoven, at this period of his life, was not only preoccupied with motivic frugality, he was also preoccupied with being Beethoven. And in the Appassionata Sonata, I'm disturbed by an egoistic pomposity, a defiant, let's just see if I can't get away with using that once more attitude, which on my own private Beethoven poll places this sonata somewhere between the King Stephen Overture and the symphony Wellington's Victory.